To understand how the male reproductive system works, let's have a look at the composition of the system. The external genitalia include the penis, the scrotum, the testes. You can see only one here, but of course, you know, you should have two testicles, right? Whereas the internal genitalia include the epididymis, the vas deferens, the seminal vesicles, the ejaculatory ducts, the prostate gland, and finally the pulpourethral or Cowper's gland. Let's begin with the testes. Normal testis measures approximately 5 cm in length by 3 cm in width and about 15 to 25 ml in volume. The testis is composed of two compartments, tubular and inner tubular space. The main part is the tubular part, which forms around 90% of the testicular volume. It's the seminiferous tubules. So let's zoom in on a seminiferous tubule and take a cross section through the tubule just to see what's inside. The center of the seminiferous tubule is called the lumen, and the outer layer is called the basal lamina. The lumen is surrounded by Sertoli cells and spermatogonial germ cells in various stages of development. Closer to the basal lamina are the mother germ cells, where the immature sperm cells are produced and develop as they move inward toward the lumen. The Sertoli cells, also known as supporting cells, as they provide mechanical and nutritional support for spermatogenic cells. The other compartment of the testis is the inner tubular space that contains everything lies between the seminiferous tubules, mainly the Leydig cells that make up the endocrine portion of the testis, the blood vessels also, lymph vessels, nerve, collagenous fibers, macrophages, and variety of connective tissue cells. Sperm production is a hormone-dependent process controlled by extratesticular and intratesticular hormones. Simply, the pituitary gland releases the gonadotrophins, the follicular stimulation hormone, FSH, and luteinizing hormone, LH, that bind with the receptors in the testis. FSH bind with Sertoli cells, LH bind with Leydig cells. FSH stimulates the Sertoli cells to support spermatogenesis, and LH stimulates testosterone production by the Leydig cells. But have you ever wondered why your testicles are literally always hanging out of your body? That's because the testes need to be at temperatures 2 to 4 degrees Celsius below the body temperature. That's needed for the spermatogenesis, the sperm production process, to occur efficiently. And that's why you have the scrotum. The scrotum has several characteristics that help in maintaining the hypothermic testes, which mean to keep your testes temperature lower than your body temperature. These include the thin scrotal skin, minimal subcutaneous fat, and large number of sweat glands that are activated by the increase in the external temperature. In addition, the scrotal skin hangs loose and wrinkled with a large total surface area that adjusts according to the ambient temperature. That's why your testes are hanged away from your body in hot weather, or like if you are in a hot bath, and you can barely feel them there in a cold winter, as the scrotum shrink and drag them close to the heat, close to your body, just as you shrink when you feel cold. Back to the sperm factory, the testes. Seminiferous tubules are surrounded by several layers of myoid cells, which like smooth muscle. These cells contract to push the mature and motile sperm toward a network of tubes called reti testis, and from there to spermatic duct called the epididymis. The epididymis is the place where the final step of maturation happens, where the sperm are bagged and stored to be shipped later to the final destinations, once the order is received from the brain. The epididymis can be divided into three parts: the head, which is called the caput, the body, known as the corpus, and the coda, which represent the tail of the epididymis. It's important to note that before they enter the epididymis, sperm are immotile and incapable of fertilization. But while they make their way along the epididymis, sperm undergo important morphological and functional changes that make them ready to swim and have the ability to fertilize an egg. In caput, fluid from the reti testis are absorbed and replaced by secretions from the epididymal epithelium. As a result of water absorption, sperm concentration increases in the next region. Moving to the second part, the main segment of the epididymis, the corpus, where the most significant maturational changes happen. The most obvious morphological change is the translocation of the cytoplasm droplet from an initial position around the neck to the distal region of the middle piece. Sperm cells also undergo biochemical changes, mainly to the plasma membrane. This includes the increase in the unsaturated to saturated fatty acid ratio, also a decline in the total cholesterol concentration. According to these changes, the plasma membrane biophysical properties also change, makes them more fluid, more suitable to undergo capacitation, hyperactivation, and acrosome reaction. All these processes are required for sperm oocyte binding. So basically, here they gain the ability of interaction, fusion with the egg, and fertilization itself. Also, there is a change in the glycosidic and protein composition of the sperm plasma membrane, but modifications are not limited to the head. Proteins of the sperm tail get cross-linked by a disulfide bond. As a result, sperm tail becomes strong and able to bend, so they have the potential for motility. Then sperm reach to the last segment of the epididymis, the coda, which primarily serve as a storage site for functionally mature spermatozoa. When a man is sexually stimulated, the order for ejaculation is delivered to the epididymis through the nerve system, and the epididymis responds to this stimulation by initiating of contraction, squeezing waves that push the sperm into the different duct, which also called the vas deferens. Like what happened in the epididymis, during ejaculation, the smooth muscle of the different duct contracts, thus pushing the sperm and the fluid forward and transferring them to the ejaculatory duct, where sperm cells are mixed with the fluid secreted from the next gland, which is the seminal vesicles. Seminal vesicles are two glands located next to the end of the vas deferens. The size and the activity of these vesicles are androgen dependent, which means in the absence of the androgen, the seminal vesicles will degenerate. And in the presence of the androgen, these vesicles will start releasing their fluid. That fluid contributes to the bulk of the ejaculate, which around 60% of the final semen volume. It's a thick, alkaline, viscous, yellowish fluid that contains the sugar fructose, the energy source for the sperm, just like the fuel for your car. Sperm motility stimulators include potassium, bicarbonate, magnesium, prostaglandin, and prolactin. Also coagulation factors, mainly seminologen 1. It's a protein that expressed exclusively in the seminal vesicles. That's why semen coagulates after contacting with the seminal vesicles fluid. Also, it has reactive oxygen species scavengers, such as ascorbic acid, commonly known as vitamin C. ROS scavengers are believed to preserve the functional competence of spermatozoa exposed to an oxidative stress. A side note here, if you don't know what is reactive oxygen species, it's a type of unstable molecule that contains oxygen and that easily reacts with other molecule in a cell. The increase of ROS production in a cell may cause DNA damage, RNA damage, or also protein damage, and may end up in cell death. In semen, reactive oxygen species is mainly produced by white blood cells and sperm cells. During ejaculation, the muscular tissue and elastic fibers of the seminal vesicles contracts to empty its fluid into ejaculatory ducts, shortly after the vas deferens has emptied the sperm into those ducts. That pushed the mixture of sperm and fluid secreted by the seminal vesicles forward to the urethral duct, the pathway that both semen and urine take to leave the body. Ejaculatory ducts connect to the urethra within a chestnut-shaped gland located underneath the bladder, called the prostate gland. The prostate gland, it's a muscular gland that surrounds the first inch of the urethra as it comes out from the bladder. Like the seminal vesicles, prostatic structure and function are androgen dependent. So it starts to produce, store, and secrete its fluid after puberty. The prostate fluid is a clear, acidic fluid, has a pH around 6.6, which contributes to about 1/3 of the final semen volume. So now we know from where the major semen volume came from. It's from the seminal vesicles and the prostatic gland, not from the testes. Only sperms come from there. Prostatic fluid provides many components to the semen, such as calcium, zinc, citric acid, and acid phosphatase. Also contains seminal plasmin. It's an antimicrobial protein that fights urinary tract infection. Also very important is the prostate-specific antigen, PSA, a protease enzyme that breaks down the protein of the seminal coagulum. So seminal vesicles provide protein that initiate coagulation, and PSA, or the prostate, provide the PSA that break those protein down to help semen liquefy after ejaculation. All these components enter the urethra by prostatic ducts, then the smooth muscle of the prostatic gland contracts during ejaculation to participate to the explosion of semen from the urethra through the penis outside the body, making the end of the story. But wait, there are still something we didn't discuss. That little thing under the prostate, it's the pulpourethral gland. This gland secretes a clear, alkaline, viscous mucin. The alkalinity of the fluid helps in protecting the urethra by neutralizing the acidity. The mucin serves as a lubricant during intercourse. Also, this fluid has a very important role in the ejaculation as it helps to lubricate the urethra for sperm to pass through. Also, flush out any urine before the semen is ejaculated.